Gives me great pleasure to introduce Mark Burry to the AA. Mark Burry has been actually at the AA for 48 hours of a treadmill in our DRL Phase 2 juries, straight off a 24-hour flight from Australia. I'm quite amazed that you have the longevity to agree to lecture after 2 days of juries. And we really thank you for taking that sort of extra effort to lecture to us here tonight. Professor Mark Burry from RMIT in Melbourne, who directs the Spatial Information Architecture Laboratory, which is a creative think tank that works with all sorts of academics and outside professionals. As well, Mark is a consultant to the Temple of Sagrada Familia in Barcelona, Gaudi's seminal work, which over the period of this last and even possibly for centuries on, Mark's research has helped to shift the mode of production of Sagrada Familia from the kinds of material computation that was being worked on in the early stages of production to applying digital media towards the production of complex form, stone cutting, casting, etc. techniques. Mark has achieved notoriety as a consultant and operating, say, between the disciplines of mathematics, computation, architectural production, to consultancies provided to Arabs in Melbourne, Decoy in Paris, Mark Goldthrop, long-standing collaboration, as well more recently with Gary Partners in LA. It gives me great pleasure to introduce, join me please in welcoming Mark Burry.
Thanks, Tom, for the introduction. If I'm not suffering from jet lag myself, the computer has shown signs this afternoon, so I have backup, as they say. I'd just like to thank the institution for the invitation. It's been a really amazing couple of days, fairly brain-extending. And I originally proposed to talk about the work of Antoni Gaudi, particularly with the Sagrada Familia, as a means to discuss the status of the drawing and the model. But after so many projects which actually were teasing at the whole issue of fabrication, I think I will ad lib along the way and show just some of the implications of taking this stuff through from idea to making. Gaudi for me is the architect that's interested me from the very beginning of my interest in architecture. I just admired the way that every sense is touched by his work, and every sort of intellectual process is engaged by the challenges that he sets through his work with us as participants. And so I've been working on the Sagrada Familia since 1979, when I went there as a student, having just finished my first degree in my year out. I actually was doing a thesis the year before, and went to get some material. I was particularly interested in how Gaudi buildings got built, that question was asked of the two directors, both of whom, well, one was 90, the other was a sprightly 89-year-old, who had worked with Gaudi themselves as young architects, and they were running the show at that time. So I asked them the question, and they said, "Well, this is a good time to come here, and you can help us answer the questions yourself," which led to an internship. It was one of those lucky breaks. I could have gone there 6 months earlier or 6 months later, and it may not have happened. But so what I want to do in the 50 minutes that I've been allotted, plus I might take a 10-minute overrun, what I want to do is just actually go through that adventure from the beginning through to now. It has several motives. One is to locate the work in terms of current practice, because I think, at least I'll try and convince you that that actually it's the creative, it's our creative selves that's the most important thing, not the instrument. And of course, the instrument is very pervasive at the moment, and there, we still have the camps, the Luddites versus the keen adopters. And I'm not yet reached the age of being a cynic, but I'm certainly a skeptic, and that may come through. Let's begin with a quick review of Gaudi, the man. This is the young Gaudi, just so we know that we're talking about a person, not myself. And this image, which is taken from this building, it's looking along here. And words almost fail me to... I don't know, many of you would have seen this and just looked at it and wondered what on earth was going on in his mind to be able to do, not only conceive this, but get it done. And when you look at it side on, that's the image that I think is the one that I will begin with. It's the challenge of, first of all, conceiving this and then getting it made. How do you describe this? What's the process by which you, first of all, ideate, communicating with yourself, then how do you communicate with others to get the sort of seamless joints? Gaudi, of course, works at all levels, and I will be focusing on the technical and the representational tonight, not the philosophical. Alas, it's not time to do everything. But the, of course, his work is so challenging compositionally in terms of what he's trying to say through the architecture, that this is possibly the reason why a lot of the questions which I found myself asking in the 1970s weren't being asked then, and I think have been asked relatively relatively recently. I like the fact that he was able to work with inert materials such as wood, which had originally been an organic growing medium, and somehow capture life within the material. You can just see there's something in this wood that's trying to get out, these little buds bursting. I'm going to talk about this a bit more when I come back in a couple of months for the conference. But it's the sense of life in his work that I found appealing. I like the haptic relationship between the object, the design, and its use. These are the some fittings from the building. I like the fact that they're utterly contemporary in terms of their freeform shape, except, of course, it doesn't take a lot of imagination to see that by grabbing hold of some clay, you can probably form this handle, which is exactly what was done. The immediacy of the point of the handle and its point of contact shape, very pre-digital, but also very post-digital. This building is one of the three projects that were his the nadir of his career, and I can't really go into the whole history of it, but I would like to share the following facts. It's a steel frame building, not a stone building, as most people immediately imagine. So it's a very early example of a building that's been made of stone, as if it were stone, but it's actually hung off a very complicated steel structure. And Gaudi, the innovator, of course, wasn't able to find a contractor who was able to build the steel frame, but like all good innovators, stepped out of his own domain and sniffed around in the other, which was the boatyard. And so it was a boat builder that actually produced a steel frame for this building. Again, we could spend a long time arguing or discussing where it came from in terms of its provenance. Is it a quarry? That's the popular name, La Pedrera, is the quarry. What are these curves? What are the sinuous? Is it a maritime expression? Well, we have to put that to one side because it's not tonight's point, but what I would like to talk about is these joints and their precision. I don't know how accurate the information that I'm going to quote is, but it, taken with a pinch of salt, it will serve the purpose. My understanding is that the building came in at four times the cost for an apartment block of its size and location. It was built as a speculative adventure for the client, Mrs. Miller. She is the one with the money, but Mr. Miller was the one who actually wanted to invest it for her. Not only did it come in at four times the cost, it also took far longer than it was supposed to. It coincided with the 1909 Semana Tragica, which was a routine uprising against the church, seen as an instrument of state. So all the religious adornment that Gaudi had planned, particularly the sculpture by Carlos Mani in the corner, was erased from the project by the client, which of course wouldn't have pleased Gaudi too much. My understanding is each piece of stone had to be modelled at 1:1 from plaster of Paris, and a lot of people who've been presenting the work in the last 2 days will be sympathetic, as probably that was the sort of technique they thought they would use themselves. So each piece of stone modelled at 1:1 plaster of Paris at ground level, cut at ground level, lifted up using an apparatus that Gaudi himself had to design, placed against its neighbour and matched many times, of course, the stone wouldn't exactly fit, so it would have to be lowered back down to the ground again and be recut. On average, 4 times, I believe, for each piece of stone. The project, by the time it was finished, it was not able to be entered into the competition for the best building of Barcelona. It had been anticipated that it would be a worthy candidate, but they decided to wait a year for the interior to be completed, by which time the architectural taste had gone from the Modernista, this wacky period, to the Nelsentista, which I think best described as anal. And fair? So it never got even a listing for the prize. We can see in Casaballo, which is the first project I showed you, the hint of mathematics. We don't know what that surface is, but we've seen a lot of the surfaces that look very like it during the last couple of days. Same with this one here. We can't say what this is exactly, but a mathematician probably could. But there's obviously a sense that there's a kind of mathematical sensibility creeping into the work. This image, of course, sums up the unhappy ending. This is Gaudi in some kind of combat with Mila, the client's husband. They are arguing over the fee, the fact that this guy wouldn't pay this guy his fee. Gaudi ended up having to take a key member of the bourgeoisie to the tribunal and won his fee, but never performed any architectural service for a secular building thereafter. So this is one of three problems. This happened around about 1911, 1912. But the other project, which came a bit unstuck, resonates today for what it means in terms of its composition, its strategy, but was a profound disappointment to Gaudi in the sense that only a fraction of it was built. Probably all recognize this model, but just in case there's somebody who doesn't, I'll labor the point, because I think the point has to be labored for all those people who have been experimenting with force fields and behavioral agents and this and that. Here's the original. I think it's the first example I'm aware of an interactive model that's been used to experiment in architectural form. It's a model at 1:10 of a church, the Colonia Güell church just outside the city of Barcelona. It's hanging upside down because it's representing through little bags of birdshot, through tension, what the building would be doing if subjected to compression. So the idea is you actually load up bits of the building with extra weight to pull it and deform it. And you then take the photograph of the building. So that's what I call the pre-digital Maya. And this is the pre-digital Photoshop. The model's been photographed. It's sailcloth inside it. It's been photographed and painted over the top by Gaudi himself. So this is as close as he came to any kind of conventional plan section and elevation. So we can see in this process, it went from 1896 through to 1904, or 1906. It was 8-year process, design process. So this is an 8-year design process. And we can see that Gaudi has eschewed the need for the conventional plan section elevation from the very beginning. So compositionally, he has a strategy which is three-dimensional, four, if you include the fact that it's an interactive model. And we can see that he's found other techniques to represent the building in terms of its formal expression. Here's another picture of it. You can see the state of these drawings. There's hardly any material surviving from Gaudi. There's literally a couple of dozen of drawings, possibly, maximum. He didn't write a word in his professional career other than the odd letter, so there's no theory in writing, and there's, as I say, hardly any archive of 2D material. Certainly the model didn't survive, although it's been reconstructed. But there is a wealth of 3D material, which is what I'll be focusing on. The interior, the camera was just stuck through the sailcloth and photographed, and then the photograph painted over, so that's the interior. But of course, none of what I'm showing you here was ever built. Only the basement was built in the following 6 years. So the whole process took 14 years, 8 years for the design and 6 years for the construction of the basement crypt. So that's 14 years. If we take 14 years just to keep ourselves mentally alert at this late time in the week, if we take 14 from 2006 and imagine that we're in 1992, if you just find an event in 1992, okay, I'm trying to give human interest here. So if 1992, something happened, right? You remember that, it's a long time ago. Imagine that you have been focusing on this building. It's one of the main projects in your career. It's Gaudi's middle age at this point. And we get to this point, which is the crypt itself, and then the client, for a number of reasons, decided not to continue with the building. So this is, for me, without any question, the most remarkable architectural space I've ever experienced. You know, probably not really interested in my experiential matters, but just the fact that I find this everything. It is important in terms of what I'm going to show for the Sagrada Familia, because it's so different in many respects, but surprisingly similar. It's a very rational building. It's a Baroque plan. It's overstructured, as you can see. These naturally occurring basalt prisms, Gaudi felt was... this is stone that came out of the ground, this shape. Gaudi's actually hacked away to get it a bit more tension there. He's even thought of the lead joints, so that as the building got higher, it would obviously be this building that's based on perfect structural performance, which is something I didn't emphasize, but it's basically based on perfect structural performance, that as the building gets higher, it would start relaxing into its ultimate form, and he's even thought of that by having these soft articulations. On the outside of the building, we can see that he's begun to experiment with ruled surfaces, the hyperbolic paraboloid, and this is where math starts coming in to the conversation. It's not very complex math, at least I can handle it, so it's doable. These are one of three surfaces that he used. We're going to look at them in great detail. So I thought if we could just look at them in a more sensate manner first, and then we can actually sort of roll our sleeves up and get to what they mean in terms of formulae and all the rest. But just here you can see, and just here, these are hyperbolic paraboloids. They're not intersecting, they're just features. They give that wonderful sinewy sort of sense of tension. And on the outside of the building, we see the same surfaces being used, these wobbly surfaces. Again, we've seen quite a few of these in the last couple of days. These are actually formed by these ruled surfaces. Another thing that's very interesting about this building is the economy. Whether as there might not be economy of means in terms of the construction techniques, there's certainly an economy in terms of what it's made from. This is recycled brick, the stuff that comes out of the... When you fire bricks, there's always a number that get overcooked. Am I cooking? And the grills over the windows are made from the needles that were used to make the corduroy. This is a little church on the outskirts of Barcelona to service the needs of a colony of workers. So it's an extremely modest building in terms of materials, but extremely advanced in terms of its concept. The building was built from the model. The model was hanging in a shed upside down right next to the site, and so rather than consulting drawings, the builders would just go through to the shed and take measurements and place these columns in their proper location. Unfortunately, UNESCO has had a hand in restoring the building. I have to do the inverted commas on the restoring. It's I'm not sure what people have seen it. It certainly seems to have been sanitized to the extent that these columns, which used to lie scattered around in the field outside the church, had been removed. And I thought this was one of the most poignant sights to see bits of a building that would never be completed just lying in sort of elegant repose, as I say, not required. So the upshot was that we had two projects, the third being Parkwell, which came to a bad end from Gaudi's point of view. And so 1914, he disappeared from view and went to the Pyrenees for a convalescence from something called Maltese fever, that I strongly suspect was some kind of total breakdown. And I know that he was in bed for quite a few months, and so I can imagine that he would have been lying, looking up at the ceiling, wondering where his life was going. He was 62 in 1914. That's a reasonable age for anybody. And he had this building here, which is the Sagrada Familia Church, that he'd worked on right from the beginning of his career, with only the one transept and the apse built in his time. When you look at this photograph, you sort of get the sense that not a lot has happened since. It still seems to be remarkably unfinished, because it is very unfinished. This is just the two transepts and the nave. The statistics that you'll be wanting to know, I imagine, is that the interior will be completed at the end of 2008. This isn't a hypothesis anymore, it's actually an instruction. The Sagrada Familia has moved in the 21st century and discovered this thing called management. So it's 2008 for the interior, but I think we've been allowed 20 years for the exterior. So this isn't a drawing from the office, I might hasten to add. It's an interpretation, but it's the only one we have of the kind of three-dimensional aspect. It certainly wasn't by Gaudi himself. I'm going to show you some of those. Now, Gaudi didn't actually start the building, which is one of the reasons why it's different from the Colonial World Church. Apart from the fact that he commenced work on this in 1883, he qualified in 1878. It had actually been commenced by Del Villar, an architect, Dalesian architect, the year before. But Del Villar had resigned on the basis that the client was obliging him to use random rubble as an economy measure. And original architect said that he wasn't in a position to be instructed by his client on how to go about his professional office. So he resigned. And for reasons that are very obscure, but the best story is the parish architect commissioner had a dream that the architect for the project needed to have, would have piercing blue eyes, which apparently is what Gaudi had. So for those of you got piercing blue eyes, you know, use them, flaunt them. Without a single project to his name, as far as I can tell, because Casa Vicens has been, which is the house that's covered in tiles, has been relocated historically to about 5 years after it's usually cited as being 1878 has been completed, but since it's when Gaudi qualified, and it's 1885, Gaudi was given this important commission with nothing to his name. So again, aim high. I also should say, since we're in an academic institution, that Gaudi was a spectacularly bad student. He had to repeat a lot of his courses. So that's good too, isn't it? So this is what he had to work with. This is his starting point. And there's a big difference between that image I showed you before and this. Important, I think, to contextualize just in the way that we try and imagine what it would have been like to have had these three projects. The Parkwell, by the way, was a housing scheme for 60 houses, and the infrastructure took so long and cost so much. That's what makes it a wonderful park for us today, that only two out of the 60 houses were built. So it folded as an enterprise and became a public park very soon after. I think it's important to contextualize what it might mean to have these three projects stalled or compromised in this way. Also, I think we need to think about what it must have been like to work on this building in that time too. And of course, for most of the time that Gaudi would have been working, he would have been seeing the building as this, not the tourist icon that it's become in the center of the Ensanche or Eixample of Barcelona. This is very great, isn't it? There's the sheep or goats going past, very different from now, but they serve to distract you from the confidence with which the commissioners must have planted these trees in the centre. I mean, I'm just wondering what it must have felt like for the architect to be told that there's these trees planted, because they had no expectation of the building, obviously, getting anywhere. So, anyway, that's just my surmising there, you can probably tell. So this is just a quick tour of the building from the outside. There's the original transept. Gaudi died just after this first finial was completed. The rest was still in scaffolding. For those who are curious, he was run over by a tram, age 74. And I had to give a presentation to the Prime Minister of Australia a month or two ago on how creativity could help the Australian economy. This is part of a group. So I made the aside that these trams must be a lot quieter than the Melbourne trams, because we have 750 kilometres of trams and they're very noisy. I still look at them when I'm idle moments, wondering how you get run over by one. But anyway, that's what happened to Gaudi. And so he saw one of the finials completed and the apse, and that's in its total. So age 74, something less than 5% of the building completed in its time. Did it have prospects for completion? Well, a lot of people felt that it didn't at a practical level or at a financial level. And certainly for a lot of the last century, there was opposition for its continuation from a kind of philosophical level. Who would presume to be the Gaudi successors? Here's what it looks like from the crane. So you can see there's the apse and the first transept, and the most of the innards now seem to be approaching completion. There's the crossing, so one half of it is now completed, and the apse has been built up to here. I'm going to show you give you a sense of progress. Here's the main facade. It's actually now built to this level here. One of the reasons it's being built quickly is to make sure it goes in before the fast train Paris to Madrid, which has been rescheduled, I believe, to go along the Mallorca Street. So rather than this building conforming to the needs of the Renfe, it's trying to get around the other way around. But for a lot of the last decade, it was a surprising thing. You see the building being completed so emphatically on two sides and at the apse, but at the end it's just been left open. Of course, part of the reason for this is that whilst the whole of the building fits on the site, the entrance level is about 5 metres above road level, so it needs a bridge across to where these flats are. So this is the passion facade. That's what we're working on currently. When I say we, I mean myself and colleagues in Melbourne. I'll talk about the working method soon. Now, this is only half the facade as drawn by Gaudi. There's the top parts missing. When I arrived at the building in 1979, this had been completed the year before. And they were just beginning, they being these the two directors, were just beginning to think about what would happen for the nave. And that's when I had these two questions. First of all, where was the authority to continue the building with less than 5% complete during Gaudi's time? And the other question was, and how do you communicate the nature of the building to the people building it? And they pointed to boxes and boxes of dusty, shattered plaster of Paris model in the corner, and they said, well, you've just arrived at the time when we have to really look at these with some seriousness, because Gaudi had a system, a mathematical system with which all the surfaces are described. It's just a question of unravelling them and applying them, and hence the invitation to work there. This is what it looked like in 2000. That's the at ground level. This is the apse, and the nave is nearing completion at the south end, and they're just beginning to put the scaffolding in. And last November, you can see that the crossing, as I say, it's half complete, and the apse is built right up to the first ambulatory level at the top. And really that date of late 2008 looks as if it might be achievable. Another view from 2000 from the crane, looking down, there's the first part of the connection with the second transept, the western transept. And here it is in November with just the roof to go on. Just to give you a sense of scale, we're looking at this. Looks, you know, human. When I went up the crane, was just complimenting myself that late 40s I still had the whatever it was required to go up the crane. I was experiencing vertigo for the first time ever. It wasn't serious, but then I looked around and saw there was this guy hanging from this. The lightning had struck the top, and it was these guys were out fixing it. But then I thought he had problems, and I noticed this guy. So this is my, where is the image of the hanging model is my most important image in terms of making an architectural statement of form finding, and the columns and repose are ones is my most pathetic architectural image. This is my most nightmarish image. This is something that I don't like to look at for too long. That this guy was climbing in and out under the, imagine that, you know, 100 meters up in the air in a fishing net. There's the south facade, that's the principal entrance. And just a quick few images to show that it's quite a complicated project to build. These are the center vaults being made from Catalan vaulting. Gaudi had this idea that innovation would occur at the design level, but you wouldn't innovate at a construction level unless you had to. Quite an interesting idea. The idea is that you use traditional systems because you know they work, rather than experiment for the sake of experimentation. I think it's a good lesson. Here's a hint of these ruled surfaces again. This is the shuttering for these vaults here. And here is the entire working drawing collection for the crossing. If I get time, I'll show you what the crossing looks like, but that's basically the main vaults above the center of the church. And it's a very important drawing. It's got a little roof over it. Two sets of information. One is the code. Each of these pieces just refers to an actual element, a precast element. And the other one, which is very spatial, is simply where these elements go in space. So an X, Y, and Z coordinates. And here's what Gaudi did for the last 12 years of his life. So having been abandoned from these three principal projects, he then set himself the task of completing the design for the Sagrada Familia at a scale of 1 to 25 and 1 to 10. So this is a 1 to 25 scale model of the building, and there are elements which we'll start exploring in detail at a scale of 1 to 10. Now, this is new stuff. This is what the original architect had proposed. This is all about this series of slides is all about ambition. So this is what the architect first proposed. He went on to up his project a little bit more. So you can see effectively when Gaudi inherited this building, he was asked to help complete a parish church, not a cathedral. It isn't a cathedral now, but it's popularly known as the Cathedral of the Poor. This is the very un-Gaudi-like looking plan of the apse. It shows the bits that had already been built when he was engaged to do the crypt. This is the first Gaudi drawing that I've been able to find. It's dated about 1890. So he's been on the project for 7 years, and it's the drawing of the apse from behind with a hint of the rest of the church behind it. In 1898, he drew the Nativity facade, which is the Gaudi facade, and a few years later he drew over it a kind of structural resolution for the building that's going to go on top of it. And in about 1910, I believe, the silhouette of the building appeared. The plan is an adaptation of the original. This is the final plan that Gaudi confirmed. It's still the plan today. There has been no significant change. Very important piece of information that, because it's a building that effectively designs itself without the master necessarily being there to direct. From his point of view, it was never a building to be looked at orthogonally. Just as the Colonial World Church was going to be this Baroque experience, he did what he could to make this a non-axial building. And unfortunately, in 1916, the local government denied most of his requests, but this was the layout that Gaudi had asked for those fields that we saw the cows and goats in, was to have this star-shaped plaza so that you were actually having your eye directed to oblique views. Incredibly modern sort of idea, don't you think? Here's the first section of the building. It appeared in about 1917. It's a hybrid between sort of wacky stuff and conventional Gothic. So it looks like from the outside the building would look like a Gothic Revival building, which was the kind of the style that of all the drawings that preceded it, particularly by the original architect. We note that the columns, though, are beginning to lean, so the lessons he learnt from the funicular model hadn't been wasted. He could actually apply this to the structural resolution of the building. The remarkable things that he did in this building was to attack the deficiencies of Gothic, they being over mass, the huge piers and pinnacles that were required to stop the lateral thrust. And he did this by bringing the thrust inwards through these choir. It's called the choir. It's sort of a horseshoe shape that goes around the perimeter of the building and brings the forces, lateral forces, in rather than out through the piers. And by doing this, it meant that the windows themselves could become screens. So rather than having those the sort of occlusion that you get from the piers to a typical Gothic cathedral, this is going to be a very light and airy building. This is the a version of the final section. You can see that it's a lot more refined than the original. The columns, which you can see, have a twist in one sense. In fact, became something quite different, which I'll show you. And all that structural force is highly resolved in terms of coming down and being directed through the axes of the columns. Thinking big, one thing that happened in the 1890s was a bequest for a lot of money from an individual. And rather than put it to building a metre a year rather than half a metre, or whatever the rate was, Gaudi decided tactically to build one of the transepts to get the building as high as possible, to give a sense to the people donating for the building, because it's a building that's not funded by any central authority, it's funded entirely by donation. The idea by giving a sense that it really was going to be built in their lifetime. But as you can see from these series of images that appeared from 1917 to 1919, it began to be compared in the propaganda associated with the building. There's a little magazine that came out every month or so. It started being compared to the great buildings of Europe, the great cathedrals, and you can see there, for instance, there's St. Mark's in Venice, and there's the Sagrada Familia next to it. So it's going to be of cathedral proportions, even though it was a church. Now, this is the first real drawing of the building, 1906, so Gaudi's now been working on it for 23 years. This is the first drawing to appear of the project, yet it's not drawn by Gaudi, but by his assistant, Rubio. And you can see that it's taken from, you can see from the view that it's an orthogonal view, an oblique view, not an orthogonal view, really reinforcing this desire by Gaudi to sort of take the building away from the kind of Latin cross. As the years rolled by, it appeared in five versions. So he did this first one through Rubio in 1906, which is 20 years before he died. This one appeared in various forms in 1913, 15, 17, and 22. It's an adaptation for publicity purposes. That's why it's got this stuff on the top. You can see that apart from the very kind of Gaudi-esque treatment for the transepts, the rest of it, the apse, of course, is already built, but the nave was being seen as this kind of Gothic revival. And this is 1914, this drawing, still this Gothic revival. Here we are, 1925, the year before he died, Gothic revival. But we see the change from the sacristies, which are on the corners of the north end of the building on either side of the apse. They start taking this parabolic form, which is also the form of the centre towers, as well as the other 17 towers. Big difference, though, when we get to 1929, this is 3 years after he died, his models, which he'd worked on for the last 12 years, start making an appearance. So it's just this area here, you can see a big difference between this Gothic revival rose window and something which is quite different. And we're going to look at the design and development of those shortly. The bits that Gaudi didn't model or draw are hatched here. So the current debate is are these hatched by Gaudi because he didn't have time to complete them, or in the absence of lifts, did he assume, like all Gothic cathedrals, that these spaces would be service spaces for bells but not for the public? The plan forever, as far as I know, since this drawing, has been to have visitors coming to the top. So the project that I'm personally involved at the moment is the design of this tower, with focusing on this space here. So whereas, as you'll see from the evidence that I'm going to show you, that there's these models of all this building, this was never modelled, and so this is the only part of the building that's effectively going to be done without the master's direct touch. However, he did leave clues. So the sacristy, which you can see here, the model, it survives as a broken model, is very geometrical in its construction, and it has even has a template for its a very large scale for its founding geometry. The idea is that this is the prototype for all the towers. So the missing evidence for this tower here, we may have thought we had carte blanche, but in fact, there was a schema in the form of this sacristy here. This is a drawing also published in 1929, but apparently was drawn before Gaudi died, showing the structural resolution. So Gaudi was a complete architect in the sense that he was perfectly at home, whether looking at the construction of buildings, the appearance of buildings, the functioning of buildings, or even the static performance. And the engineers who currently work on the buildings say there's nothing wrong with the load calculations in this, and therefore all the columns have been built to the size and angles that these drawings predicted. So this is the state of the building. This photograph was taken in 1930. Sorry, it's dated 1930, but it's suspected to be 1917. And you can see that this is the environment that Gaudi worked in. He didn't sit at a drawing table. He'd worked alongside the model makers building the final design for this project. The process. So, there's the models, and these are the surfaces. This is one of three surfaces. This is the hyperboloid of revolution on one sheet. It's a parametric model, even though it hasn't got a computer attached to it. Ali was asking earlier on, what is parametric design anyway? It's a state of mind. It's not a algorithm or a mandate from a computer software company. It's a state of mind. It's the idea that, just as I showed you with the organic nature of the treatment that Gaudi gives to stone and wood, that there's actually life in buildings, regardless of how inert their fabric is. Equally, there's life in their description. So rather than seeing surface as a free form, he could see it as something like this, which is a surface which resides somewhere between a cylinder and two cones. Unfortunately, I can't follow this up with an image of it immediately, but there's a surface in there that's somewhere between these two states. So this is a parametric model because it says that if you do one thing with this ring holding the strings compared to this one, you'll get a cylinder, but if you rotate it 180 degrees, it'll come round to being two cones opposite each other. But of course, there's this wonderful surface in between. These mathematical models were very evident in all the schools of architecture right up until the turn of the century. If you go to the Barcelona school now, you'll still see them. I've seen them in the School of Architecture in Hungary. They're not evident in my school. In fact, probably wouldn't arrive at RMIT wearing your mathematics credentials on your sleeve, because it might well make you ineligible for architecture. Deep suspicion for mathematics. But in Gaudi's time, he would have had 1/6 of his education. This is the book that he was obliged to read. I think he reset this exam several times. This is descriptive geometry. So right up until the turn of the century, 19th to 20th century, architects were obliged to look at geometry as a way to arrive at the resolution of large pieces of surface into smaller pieces of stone. He would have been aware of that surface that I just showed you. So between the cone and the cylinder, we have this hyperboloidal revolution of one sheet. And here you can see a fragment model. So when I arrived, these are the sorts of this is the material that I was given to work with. You can see on the surface, inscribed by Gaudi himself or whoever he was working with, evidence that he understood that these surfaces were ruled surfaces and that they had all sorts of opportunities. We fortunately have surviving photographs of the original models. This is a 1 to 10 model that was of the clerestory window. That's the window that runs along the length of the nave right along the top. And it was shattered into several pieces. But to the trained eye, and my eye certainly wasn't trained at the time that I arrived, but the trained eye can see that, in fact, this is a collection of hyperboloids that have been intersected. So the conundrum for anybody working on this building at that time, where we're dealing only with original material from the architect, is what surface are these two, such that you get a curve in space, a three-dimensional curve in space that runs along here? And what is the nature of this surface such that this curve between these two surfaces will intersect exactly at that point? The interesting situation is that even though the model was shattered, the photograph allows us to understand the geometrical system. That's actually a game of 60-degree equilateral triangles and a system of proportions, which is very, very exact. So we know the parameters of the placement of these surfaces. That's 3 out of the 9 variables. Each of these surfaces, by the way, have 9 variables. Those of you who are parametrically inclined, you need to pump in 9 variables to get this to be somewhere in space. So we've got 3 sorted out just by the photograph. And the challenge was then to find a way to understand the mathematics such that every point on this model, on the original model, would appear on the final project. This seems fairly obsessive, but of course the controversy of continuing the building without Gaudi in the presence of this kind of detailed 1 to 10 evidence meant that there wasn't any choice but to pursue this with rigor. And that has all sorts of implications. How did Gaudi make this in the first place? Well, because the plaster technicians and model makers have been there since he began, it means that there's been a lineage of methodology. So we know how he worked in terms of synthesis, but we have no idea how he would have worked in terms of analysis. So for the first 20 years of my involvement in this building, it was one of analysis. I didn't have to synthesize the design. I had to analyze what it was in order to be able to describe it for the next layer up to the people building it. And the model makers could show me through their own efforts, endeavors, what the process was. They would take a hyperbola, which is the section here. So you take one half of that curve, the hyperbola, and mount it on a pivot. So that's the curve there. And you can rotate it round Plaster Paris, which, as you know, takes about 20 minutes to set. So you just swivel this round, and from that you produce this shape. So in fact, you tell the model maker first what you don't want in order to make what you do want. And when you've got these surfaces, you can then combine them in this way, and there are these three-dimensional curves. That's the intersection between these two surfaces, and this is the all-important triple point, which is the intersection of 3 of these curves in space. So you can see we didn't have any room to play with. We had to find the parameters, all 9 of them, for each of these surfaces such that the unique solution would appear here. It's unique because not only would this point have to coincide, but this point would have to coincide too. It's very easy, relatively speaking, to get this point to emerge in space, but then you'd, the wrong combination, this point would jump out. And there's the finishing of the model. Not a recent photograph. This is my year out, and I went from Cambridge University, where in my second year I had been advised not to use colour on my drawings, and in the third year I was told only to use a curve if there's a road. And what was the other one? Oh, yes, circular windows. Why would you have a window circular? They're square. That's how they make them. And I think in the third year, no models. And so I suddenly went from that late modernist Klingon period to this. And I was seriously disturbed by this because it seemed to be the anathema to all that I'd been told to believe in. I wasn't working in drawings as I understood them. I was given these archaic instruments like dividers and asked to measure these models in order to start to do the analysis. My routine correspondence with the director was at between 11 o'clock and 1 o'clock. Signor Bonnet Gary, he's, I think he was 90 in this photograph. And we worked on these large drawings, which Robin Evans writes about as being sort of 18th century trays. And that's the only drawings we were doing, these sort of analytical drawings. And the task they set me was to try and speed the modeling, because obviously doing a trial and error version of the models to try and get these intersections wasn't going to work. So they asked if I would come up with a drawing technique, and I was stumped when I realized that architecture wasn't the answer but geography, and that I should treat these surfaces as terrains. This is 1979, but utterly contemporary. Well, maybe not, maybe 10 years ago it's utterly contemporary, certainly still voguish, isn't it? To treat these surfaces as terrains and to look for the map of the terrains, look for the contours, and where the contours intersect, find these lines of intersection, these three-dimensional lines. But this was a very, very strange way to work from my point of view at the time. And when I went back to do my second, my diploma, by the way, not one person ever asked me what I'd done in my year in Spain. Times have changed, eh? So this is the... You had to work in a composite way. Again, it's fairly well understood now, working plan, section, elevation at the same time, but in 1979 it wasn't really required because things are so simple. You either did a plan, or you did a section, or you did an elevation. But we actually had to try and do this because I'm trying to find these intersections in space. And there's the equivalent of the section elevation. And... the drawings, which I've only had scanned in the last year, they've been lost in the archives, so it's been a bit of a revelation and become to my help, because I've found myself inadvertently labelled as kind of the digital guy. And I regard myself as reasonably competent digitally, but it's certainly not my... it's not what spins my wheel, particularly. So these drawings, I think, are quite important because they are very contemporary in terms of what they're attempting to do. But they predate the computer by a decade, and I did them. The drawings that we gave to the... These are the working drawings. These are the things that really... in fact, I had to resit part three, too. It's another... If I can just wear my my problem, my UK problem. When I did part three, they discounted my year. You're supposed to do 2 years of practice. Is that still the case? I don't know. But I put down my year in Barcelona as being my first year of practice, and... It was discounted. So, and I was doing working drawings, and this is them here. And here's the hyperbola that is the only piece of information that we actually needed to give the model makers, just the location of these surfaces and the characteristics for their making. This is an attempt to find the intersection of one type of hyperboloid with a whole series of others to form the ceiling. This little drawing here is just a photograph. If you look at any of these drawings that I produced, they're all the size of tablecloths. They're just covered with calculations. Again, that was something I never thought I would be doing when I went to the School of Architecture. This is even more tragic. This took a week to do. This is a rendering. I'm trying to simulate what light would be doing coming through this roof light. And this is the intersection of the column. It's not, the column's not there, but there's the capital. And I still haven't got round to actually trying to set this up on the computer to see whether it's a good result or not, but I do remember it took a whole week to calculate Rembrandt lighting and all the rest of it. This is my first computer drawing ever. In 1989, when I was re-engaged in the project, I'd heard about these things called computers. I'd just been replaced by one when I left my job in Scotland, so I was wounded, but aware. And I heard about these computers, and when they asked me if I'd the window that I'd been working on, by the way, in 1979, 1980, it wasn't until 1989 that there's actually any serious thoughts about building it. And so I was on my way back to New Zealand, and they asked if how would they go about it. I tried to explain my method, And they said the easiest thing was for me to continue, and I said, well, I would, but perhaps I should look at this thing called the computer. I spoke to the AutoCAD Johnnies, and they all told me. One guy even had the audacity to slap me on the back and say, well, Mark, you make it sound awfully complicated, but you know, for the computer, it's actually nothing. And he was right, because within a week, I'd mastered the basics of AutoCAD and found that I could draw one of these hyperboloids of revolution of one sheet in 3D quite accurately. I could also do a hyperbolic paraboloid, which is this other surface here. What I couldn't do was intersect them. And after 3 months of working away, I couldn't intersect them. And so I realized in 1989 that there was no architectural software that was useful for the Sagrada Familia. And in 2006, it's still the case. You cannot use architectural software for this project in its entirety. Very useful for doing the trays, the templates, but just not actually a goer for the real spatial stuff. So that's when I discovered that we would need to look outside of architecture and found the, I simply just worked out who, in terms of plastic sensibility of space, had more exacting problems than architects. Architects obviously had told the AutoCADs and microstations that buildings would always be orthogonal and rectilinear. So, but the product designers and the plane designers didn't have such constraints. So it wasn't actually that difficult to work out, that probably they had worked out ways to do these intersections. This is just to show you the... I was going to say, with the amazing amount of work that the students have produced in 16 months, and I was also intrigued with what Ali's been able to produce since I last saw him present 18 months ago. I better make a case for the slow food version of architecture. Unfortunately, the new management paradigm, that might have gone, but one of the things that's been really enjoyable about this project is being given the right amount of time to do the research and then to apply it. And for a long time, this has been regarded as a one-off project that had no relevance outside. But in fact, I think that this idea of research leading to an outcome, taking the required length of time, is something that we should all hope for, even if we're never provided with clients who give us that indulgence. So going on to the actual software, I'll just take you through one surface, which is the hyperboloid revolution. The strategy, I'm looking at this window and this window here, the strategy is to do Boolean subtraction. So just when I showed you in the Plaster of Paris models that the initial thing you do is make what you don't want in order to make the thing you do want, curiously the computer actually models the same process. You actually do a series of subtractions of these hyperboloids to get the surface. So you can see I've just taken a surface from this and sculpted it. Here's the basis of a parametric design. This is the hyperboloid of revolution of one sheet. There's its three axes of location, three axes of rotation. There's the A and the B for the opening, and then there's C, which dictates the curvature of the hyperbola. Parametrically, you can change any of these, and you get a very simple adjustment to just one of the parameters. You get a very simple change, but a very profound effect. And you can see here, this circular hyperboloid, I've just changed the A to B ratio from 1 to 2. And then it's been rotated three times on the three axes. And then you start getting very interesting effects just from these very simple parametric changes. Here's the effect, the actual strategy for doing the sculpting of one of these windows. We start at top left, moving down to bottom right. It's just a series of these Boolean subtractions. And this is why in 1989 there just wasn't architectural software that could do this. But without these, we wouldn't have the triple points appearing as they need to. The decorative system that Gaudi applied is actually a function of the rulings on the surface. And you can see this very clearly here. So the straight lines that lie on the surface become the determinants for the actual ornamental treatment, which is extraordinary because it means that the opportunity for arbitrary design intervention is relatively small, and therefore the people like myself who are there to rehash what Gaudi had left we don't actually have any license with this material at all. It designs itself. I thought this would just be the case for the elements at this scale, but it turns out that's the way the whole building works. The plastic application of these surfaces. Here is one of these hyperboloids done as a computer thing. So it's a cylinder, straight lines. Move the one of the circles at the top in relation to the other, and we get this. And of course, this must be what was happening in Gaudi's mind. Conceptually, he was following that line of shadow, I believe. And that would be what he would use to decide. The Boolean operation, it's subtracting a cylinder from a grey brick. If you just do the simple subtraction, again, so we're actually looking at something that's not there to get what we actually want, which is a surface. If we start tinkering with the parameters to make this into a hyperboloid, then this, and again, if we just focus on that shadow there, this presumably in Gaudi's mind, without any computational assistance, he was able to envisage this and tell his plaster model makers when to stop this stopping problem issue that has occurred several times during the last 2 days. The task for us was to match a hypothetical mathematical surface with the original model, which had been digitized, as you saw in that earlier photograph. More recently, of course, the material has been scanned rather than measured by hand. This model was measured by hand. There's 550 points on the surface, and it took 6 weeks for two of us to do. Last year, my partner scanned it in 20 minutes, very accurately. So it's even in my own sort of time, you can just see things changing so quickly. If we look at this, again, this is what Gaudi's doing in his mind. He's chasing the right combination. Each frame in this animation, of course, is a set of parameters. And at some point, we arrive at a perfect outcome. To make it a bit more esoteric, conceptually, this is what is really happening. There's the surface that we're actually looking for, and these transparent surfaces are simply rotating around. Very few parameters are being changed here. It's just the rotation of the axis, and we can see what's happening. That's the original model, and that's the computer model, and that's what has been built. This is the state of the source models. In the museum, you'll see it as in its case, but this is the material that we had to work from. So as long as we had enough of these triple points, that was all. It didn't matter that there's bits missing or broken off. So he'd left a system that's mathematically rigorous and perfect in the sense of being able to impart the information to anybody coming along later without direct access to him. That's the interior. If you really want to get into serious math, which I didn't, but in 1994, we found that the parametric model needed an input. And today, again, in conversation, what is a parametric input? Where does it come from? And in this case, we're not actually synthesizing, we're analyzing. So having analyzed where these points are in space and having built a parametric model that was flexible in the way I've just shown, we then actually had to build a software with algorithms, nothing to do with me, which would actually measure the points, take them in as a data file, and there's the data file, there's these points. So this is work from 1994. I'm kind of laboring that because it all seems so contemporary, but from my point of view, it's stuff that we were doing routinely long before anybody would take it seriously as being a possible way forwards. If you look in a 1992 edition of Architects Journal, I boldly made several predictions there, which are only, I thought, in 5 years' time we would be moving into the digital age, but it seemed I was a bit ahead. So this algorithm would actually, one of two, would calculate what the ideal values for these surfaces would be. These are the nine parameters you can see here. And they would go directly to form a script. So we didn't even have to write the script. We could just generate it, and out would come the script. The script would be read by CADS 5, which was the product we used before our current thing, and this work that would take 3 months to draw and 6 months to model would be produced in 10 minutes. In this article in the AJ, I wax lyrical about what you could do with a machine as powerful as one of 125 megabytes of RAM and 2 gigabytes of hard drive. So if it took 10 minutes then, I don't know what it would take now, but you could get it so it would actually label the drawing, and it's all in 3D. So that's the world of discovery and research. There's lots more, as you can probably tell, but I'm well over time now, so I'll just quickly go through how you execute the building. I was going to sort of leave it on this discussion of representation, but I think I might take it through quickly to how we actually build the building, and I'll do this very quickly, not via that route. In 1999, we were given the first part of the building to look at, which didn't have surviving material, and it's the rosassa, the rose window in the transept here. So this space had to be filled by a window, 8 meters wide and 35 meters tall, and we were given 13 months to go from concept to completed glazed window. Here you can see this familiar technique, so we are already guided, the fact that there's a series of windows in the building, and they have a relationship with each other. The one at the bottom is a simple version, the one above it is more complex. So we're able to extrapolate a language for the composition of the window. So as I was talking about before, how you can actually find the patterning through non-arbitrary means. Equally, we were surprised to find that we weren't actually being given carte blanche at all, but we were given a very rigid, very informative schema, which we chose to be rigid about. So that's it's a parametric model, so all this geometry is fed into a model that could be built with the window actually being constructed before the model was finished, because being parametric, we're able to adjust it as time would go on. That point there, for instance, that had to coincide with an existing piece of fabric that couldn't be measured until the scaffolding was up. So rather than having to spend several weeks remodeling the building, once we got that data point, all we needed to do is put it into our spreadsheet and the model would drive. So those of you who've used parametric design, the sophisticated parametric design tools, will know that you're more likely to be working in the spreadsheet than in this environment. If you're working in this environment, you're not doing anything terribly sophisticated, in my view. It's only when you actually have a understanding of all the surfaces and their relationships such that you can just quickly make an adjustment and run the model. The stonemason was a 78-year-old based on the other side of Spain. He couldn't understand when he saw images like this on his weekly visit. I had 6 weeks on site to do the design work first before going back to Australia, and he couldn't understand how he was going to work from this material. So that brought us into the world of visualization for the first time. So although we'd been using the computer for well over 10 years, it never occurred to us that visualizing would be of any use to us. We were quite happy to work like this. We could see what was happening. He still felt this wasn't enough, so he induced us to actually start doing virtual carving. So we actually started chopping the pieces up into pieces like this. And then we discovered something called rapid prototyping, which we were very excited about. $100,000 for the machine, and 4 hours later you could produce these exquisite little pieces with precision of less than a hair's breadth. He was startled that we would think that these were useful and economical when he could produce them for half the time in polystyrene. With the added advantage, he actually had to know what he was making when he made these pieces. So whereas getting this in a little box with cotton wool was interesting and ornamental, this process, which took half the time and no cost, actually was much more intellectually useful, because he had actually needed to understand what it was he had to make. Mr. Mayo came to terms with the fact that he's going to be working with us in Australia. I think he felt he got one over us with the polystyrene models. Whenever I saw him thereafter, he always had one of these models with him, even when it was completely superfluous to anything we're going to discuss. We then had to find a method with him where we could actually communicate from Australia the information he needed to cut the stone. And here you can see these Robin Evans trays. We invented them without any realization, of course, that we were leaping into the world of two centuries previously. These blue lines here, I'll show you what they represent, but they're contours on the surface. The green lines are the straight lines you can see here, which are part of the geometry, and these little things there are 3D coordinates. So 78-year-old Mr. Mayo with his factory with one telephone was perfectly happy to work with coordinates in ways that builders that I'd worked with in other parts of my career seemed to be totally unable to fathom. Mr. Mayo was an inventor too. He realized that with these ruled surfaces, as long as you could bring this wire, cutting wire down in a plane, but could twist the stone as it went, you could then cut the surface very closely to within a centimeter of the ruled surface that was required. So he had a method of producing one of these pieces of stone every day. The more complicated pieces would take a bit longer. So that was kind of a good experience too, to realize you didn't have to be working with seven-axis mills, which I'll show you in a minute, that actually force majeure and a creative mind will lead to innovation. Here's Mr. Mayo standing next to the bottom course. The window was constructed on 18 courses, so this is the bottom sixth overall, so it's a big window. This bottom quarter was being installed on site. The next quarter was being cut in Galicia in Spain. Third quarter was still being designed in Australia, and the top quarter was still being negotiated with our colleagues at Barcelona University who were doing the intersection with the vaults. It got built. We'll leave him out. This is the point I showed you. So this point needs to be exactly against this tapering tower, which turned out to be not even built in alignment. So we had to, as the scaffolding got up, we could get that point and then just change the parametric model, even though the model had been built several months earlier. And so in the space of a half a morning, we were able to adjust to get this point to coincide exactly. And it's there for you to look at today if you've got a pair of binoculars. The precision that for the system, we weren't totally confident about, so we asked for 10-millimeter junctions to be made between the pieces of stone. If you go to the building today, you'll find there are joints that are exactly 10 millimeters wide. There's no need for these joints at all. That the system that Gaudi had set up, but never actually applied in his time, was there for us to just profit from. There's the inside of the window and the outside. And that was all done, as I say, in a period of 13 months. Now, that was in 1999 through to 2000. And I'm going to quickly finish with the current, one of the two current projects, which is also in the Passion Facade, which is the completion of the top half. If you read the Robert Hughes, Australian art critic for The Times, vitriolic account for the abuse of the Sagrada Familia by attempting to complete it, you quickly realize that in the 43 pages that he, whatever it is, he devotes to his tirade, that he hasn't worked out this is only the bottom half of the facade. That in fact, poor old Subarax, who's the collaborating artist, poor old in the sense that he's had to endure a decade of criticism without the work actually being completed. It's work of probably 20 years by the time it's finished, but actually it's derived from this drawing. So when I arrived, the fabric was already in place and Subarax had just been commissioned to do the sculpture. And this is the only material we have. There is no model, no three-dimensional material, other than the exquisite shading that you can see on the drawing. So these are the columns. And again, from the distance of Australia and a distance of 80 years almost from the death of the author, someone had to work out what these columns were. At the same time, knowing we would have to use the surfaces that he was using, these mathematical surfaces, there was no alternative. And My suggestion is that as this whole facade is representing the passion of Christ, that the idea of being suspended, Subarax has Christ hanging from a horizontal cross, which I think it must be excruciating from a vertical cross, but from a horizontal cross must be worse. So I've tried to find a way to get these surfaces to conform to what might be happening to your musculature. They look like bones, I think most people agree, in the drawing. So the novelty here was to combine hyperbolic paraboloids with hyperboloids such that the straight lines that form the boundary of this surface intersect with the straight lines of that surface. And the difficulty here mathematically is if we nominate where point P1 is, we have to actually calculate where point P2 and P3 is. So my modus operandi on this project is always when I get a new commission to do things with it that we couldn't do previously. Otherwise, it's not research, it's simply a consultancy. And to do this, we obviously need mathematicians to write the code that will go invisibly under the bonnet of Rhino and Katia that will allow us to nominate where this point is and automatically find where these two points are, or likewise find these two points and then tell us where that point's going to be. So this is the only drawing for this facade that we've done. It's what we call a schema. It's how we communicate with the mathematicians and the programmers. So all that stuff I've just probably bamboozled you with is all contained here, all the parameters that need to be thought through. Here's the column, the first prototype. Utterly, all the surfaces there are these ruled surfaces. All the lines are straight lines. There's no curves at all. A prototype. And then taking it into Katia. Now, in Katia, we need to actually, again, exert a sophistication with this instrument that we would not be able to do without. And what we're actually doing here parametrically is saying that there's a relationship in size between the top column and the bottom column, such that there's an absolute distance between the two. But whatever we change, it has to ripple through, because what I've got is these hyperbolic paraboloids are sliding past each other. The straight line of this one is intersecting with the straight line of this one. I really haven't got time to tell you all about it, but you can just see that's happening there. So if you make any change, any adjustment of the angle, all these columns are individually angled in this sense and in this sense. They're all slightly different sizes. If we make a change, it's got to be able to ripple through, which is, you know, quite high order simultaneous equations, not from a mathematician's point of view, but from an architect's point of view, quite a tall order. Because it's slow cooking rather than fast track stuff, we have the luxury of being able to make prototype versions at 1-to-1 of these three prototype columns. Here's how we communicate, usually with, it was pretty familiar now, but it wasn't when we started doing this. Certainly when we were doing the templates for the rose window I showed you before, we didn't have any of this easy access video technology. I think this is an interesting image for what it represents in terms of tool sets. My generation, this is fine. Subrak's the artist, there's his tool set. And Mr. Bonnet, who's the son of the original director, he has a slide rule about in his breast pocket and always works with pencil and paper. Rapid prototype, and then the one-to-one prototype. So first of all, the column was put on display at ground level for a critical review. And then placed up here. And over the last 18 months, there's been a series of conversations between myself and the stonemason, Jordi Barbagne, who does have a seven-axis mill. He has a five-axis stone cutter that he's got from the auto industry, and then he's adapted it with another two axes for the platter underneath it. And slowly we are adding more bits at one-to-one. Here's his machine. And really fast. Then a whole series of these tests at 1-to-1. You can see that something's wrong there. It's looking a bit better. And the ultimate parametric model is this one here. These actually slide backwards and forwards. So in seeking to find there's a lot of argument about what should be the overhang. I think they should be pronounced, but I have colleagues who don't agree. So you have this parametric physical model at 1-to-1, which can be slid in and out. What stuff. And the models get bigger, because we're now at the stage of doing stone prototypes, so instead of having these little wax models, we have big wax models. Here's this current state. The Subrax wall behind the colonnade is in place. That's looking away from the facade to the gap. There's going to be a sepulchre here with the tomb of Christ. Here's the access to the space from the tower. This is the little garden that's going to go in behind this little wet, ferny garden. So the idea is that you can walk through and up behind the wall and experience this tomb. So it's, and here you can see the parametric lozenges up above. And then finally the stone version has gone in, and we're now assessing whether it has the right texture or not. And there's Mr. Bonnet, who's 80 and proud of it, still prefers to walk up the 50 metres to the top than take the lift. I think that's just to show you the test, I kept asking students what's their test? You know, how do they know whether the things what they want? Right. This is our test. Here's the original photograph superimposed over the and you can judge for yourselves whether these columns, which do meet the requirements of the hyperbolic geometry, conform adequately. Finally, you would have seen that, but you won't. These things are quite groovy, actually. I mean, when you chop the stuff up, that's what it looks like as a whole, but it's only when you actually chop it up you realize it's got these very wonderful attributes. From the stonemason's point of view, it's just bizarre. He has these pieces that doesn't necessarily know where they're going to go in terms of the whole, but that's what it has to look like from his point of view. And just to really finish, this is the state-of-the-art stuff, you know. No time. Right, what we're doing at the moment is the Sala Crue. That's this space up here. As I say, there's no material whatsoever, not even a drawing now. But with the knowledge of where these columns come down and the knowledge that this is an ill-equilibrated structure, with the fact that we have the sacristy as the prototype, there isn't actually much for us to do other than the surface treatment. The actual form of the building is preordained. The line of the structure is preordained. But the method that we're working is not. This is the space here. So what we're looking at is how to join the main tower to the rest of the building when we don't actually know what the space is for. It's probably going to be an auditorium with a view over the whole city. And for the first time on the project, and in line with my major research thrust at the moment, is the relationship between the architect and the engineer. So for the first time, we all meet now with the engineers. That's Marguerite, I think. And so there's the digital image of the proposal. Here's the traditionally crafted model. Here you can see some rapid prototyping. And I think that this image, for me, is the one that is the best thing about our age. Because I think this is my closing remark, just to work with this and not to invest your own agency as a designer using normal hand-eye techniques is an abrogation of our opportunity. This isn't instead of, it's in addition to this. I think the remarkable thing about the Sagrada Familia has been its coming of age, in the sense that it does give us a paradigm. I didn't have a chance to show you how the even the structure conforms to these surfaces that Gaudi used. He synthesized in his last 12 years a relationship between description and formal description, which wasn't relying on the free form. It wasn't relying on pieces of stone being lifted and dropped to the ground four times in order to be reworked, but could be made exactly the first time. And that there's this kind of comfortable fusion between the latest technology and the technology that we've always had. Thank you very much. I'm going to be talking about this in March when I come here. That the big debate is that some of the material is concrete. It's called artificial stone. It's very carefully manufactured to approximate the sandstone that's no longer available, because it's most of the building is made from Montjuic stone, which is not just not available. It's a national park, can't be extracted. But the story behind the columns, I've written about it, you can find about it, but there's actually a language that Gaudi invented. He did these tests for material performance. He made a machine to test stone and selected stone on that basis. The main columns, the central ones, four of them are made of porphyry, which is the hardest stone that there is. So there's a selection.
Well, production stage, which clearly, as the technologies of manufacturing evolve, as well as the maybe the innovations of at the design stage that you're using, Rhino to Catia, as you're describing it, and then the feeding directly computationally towards the numeric control of production of stone using seven-axis machines. How has, clearly that has changed from Gaudi's principle of just adapting or adopting traditional technologies of production. And I just wonder if you can comment on the difference between maybe Sagrada Familia as a absolute one-off in its time, as the potential for its proliferation as a quite standard potential.
I didn't say that Gaudi didn't innovate constructionally. I said that he would only innovate if you had to. One of the conundrum for the Sagrada Familia is why he didn't use concrete in his work, because his major client was Count Eusebi Güell, who was the first manufacturer of Portland cement in Spain. And for decades, Güell had been producing this material that Gaudi refused to use. What happened was, in the last few years, they found a paper written by his assistant, Sagranyes, to the College of Architects, the Institute of Architects, in 1923, explaining why they would have to start using concrete for the Sagrada Familia. So there was evidence then that there was at least an intention to use this wonder material that had been eschewed disastrously, because if it used concrete at the Park Güell, for instance, a lot of the damage that came from the mortar and soft iron that they'd used wouldn't have happened. So it wasn't necessarily the right decision. But as it happens, in more recent years, they had to take a core sample from the finials at the top of the building. So the finials at the top of the towers, you might ask, how would you make those without using concrete? And the answer is that Gaudi himself didn't find a way. He did use concrete. So I think that it's the principle is that you... I think what's behind your question is, am I saying that you shouldn't innovate via the technique or the technology? I think that's a question that I often ask myself, because Gaudi, obviously, when he was exposed with new, wonderful new things, didn't necessarily say, right, this is, what can I do with this material? It was what he wanted to do at another conceptual level that was then translated through, first of all, to the most traditional possible building method. So that's probably not answering your question.
Are there any other questions?
Yes, that's what we've done. But again, it's all stuff so rushed. But if we compare the two methods, Mr. Mayo's method of 1999-2000, using kind of crude machinery versus the seven-axis mill, whilst you can see why it was of constructional advantage to use the ruled surfaces with Mr. Mayo's method, because he could adapt relatively simple technology to do, and that was one of the reasons why Gaudi used these surfaces. I don't think it's the main reason. I think he had other philosophical concerns with their occurrence in nature, for instance. But of course, the big question that we're grappling with now is, why would you even bother with these ruled surfaces if you can describe it using Meyer, freeform, and just press enter, and the seven-axis mill can cut it? So the question which I certainly asked myself very profoundly is, what would Gaudi have done if he had the computer? Would he have experimented with it, or would he have used it at all, or would he have done what we're doing with it, which is to service the need of a construct that he'd already come up with? I don't think the construct was mathematically driven. I don't think he had this sort of innate love of mathematics. I just think he could see the problem of building in this freeform way and having difficulty describing it. and then found a way to accommodate this kind of the desire for a plastic surface treatment, but in a way that was relatively buildable. And of course, I'm now contaminated goods, because the last thing I'll ever do is dick around with freeform. Because when you actually work in this, with this particular type of rigor, and this will sound very odd, but I've seen enough students now getting real pleasure driving a spreadsheet as much as they, you know, they do all-nighters using a spreadsheet because of what it does at the other end. That rigor actually gives a sort of sense of connection with the whole enterprise. And I think the problem I have with the computer is that if you rely on what's in the software programmer's mind when he or she set the thing up. And the last project we saw today, for instance, the Voronoi project, and I was asking about the signature. I think the innate desire for humans, preferably collectors rather than the hero, individual, middle-aged male, to apply a signature to their work and not be constrained by a system like the one I've just been describing is a real question. I don't know the answer. But I don't know if that's what you're driving at, but I don't think he would have returned necessarily to plastic expression having found this kind of rigor that came through the math, mostly because of the fact that you get this incredible performance benefits. The way light touches these surfaces, because of the straight lines on the surface, means you get a particular quality of light that you'll only get. The way sound will be attenuated from these surfaces because of that straight line, again, it scatters sound in the most... We assume that when it's finished that the sound attenuation of the church will be very good compared with a planar one. But mostly, most of all, structurally, if all your lines of force are in tension, which is what he strove to achieve, and those lines of force are coincident with the surface, why would you bulk out the surface with something which is less rational if you're not losing, we're not gaining anything in terms of plastic expression?
Drawings or the models, the top part that you're now beginning to work on. Are you saying that there, you have all the clues to make it, which was the case in the last project, but you don't know how it is? Therefore, there will be some sort of your own signature in there, one way or the other, which is the case of the project that we saw. That's why when you asked that question, I said my answer is yes. There is a way to have a signature in there because they've set up the system, and they know how to operate with it, and they can do different things, and they have the possibility to choose. Therefore, there is some sort of a signature in that selection. So, how do you think about this last part?
How do I reconcile that? It's a great question. The columns, I mean, who owns the columns? And whose signature goes on those? Well, I like to think that I did them better than anybody else would have done them, right? without abandoning... I mean, there were some prototypes done before. I mean, one guy spent 17 years off and on the columns, and they're overly complicated. And I think I produced a column that couldn't be simpler. There's no curved lines on it. There's minimum number of surfaces. And from the general favorable critical reaction, it seems that the prototypes, which have been up for a year and a half, are answering the need. What I like about it, you see, because one of my platforms is this whole issue of authorship, which I really can't stand. I must say it's one of the things I've particularly enjoyed over the last 2 days, is this idea of three people standing up and talking proudly in one voice of what they've done. It just seems to me that's all that matters to me. And to be involved in this project and not be Gaudi is terrific. I have no wish whatsoever. I don't think any of my colleagues do either, to be remembered as, oh, that's the bit that he did. So I think that the sense of being part of the anthill, I've had this argument, because a lot of my colleagues in RMIT don't think we should be in anthills, we should be directing the thing. But I actually think being in an anthill without necessarily... You know, you contribute quality, but you don't actually have to be identified. So that's probably personal position. Now, somebody else, I know that with Mark Gawthorpe, for instance, we've discussed this. He said to me, "Man, if I had a chance to do those columns," And I thought, yeah, well, if he didn't have a chance for those columns, we'd probably have very, you know, decoy columns. But, and there's been, you know, a lot of the debate about the continuation, like if they're going to continue it, why have they got a whole bunch of nobodies finishing it? Why isn't it Frank Gehry or Calatrava? And that the issue I have with that is that the slow food thing is that we do actually have a chance to research and not actually get under the skin of Gaudi, but certainly align ourselves. And I think that if someone like Calatrava was involved, he wouldn't necessarily feel that obligation. But quite the opposite, it wouldn't be compete, it would be to compliment, but compliment in a way you could see where one started and one finished. Well, it's a really incredibly important point, because I think one of the objections to freeform, from my point of view, is that it privileges the sculptor. And it must be very difficult for three people to do a freeform together. But if you do have a system, and nearly all the work we've seen in the last 2 days have had an underlying system, the underlying system is crucial for that negotiation across the team, I think. And that's certainly been my experience with this project. And as I say, I'd say that I'm sort of damaged goods now, because it's all I know now, and it seems to work very well. Without, you know, I don't feel constrained by it, but with the Sala Carré, I mean, why there's no need to use the surfaces at all, but I'm using them.